Hey guys, Bill Spadea here. Welcome back to my podcast. I have a very, very special guest for us. And I just want to set this up by saying that there's a lot of talk about government abuse these days, about government overreach. The word tyranny has crept into the American conversation as government takes more and more intrusive measures and steps to control your behavior, control your businesses, decide what your children are taught. Things have gone from bad to worse in the past 2 years with the lockdown. And I wanted to bring in someone who knows government abuse and tyranny firsthand. He is a survivor of communist tyranny, escaping from Castro's communist Cuba, wrote an amazing book called The Boy Who Said No. That boy is Frank Mederos, and he joins me now. Frank, great to have you on the show. How are you?
Thank you. How are you?
I'm doing great. So let's start. And what I, as we discussed earlier, and so the audience knows, we're going to do this in several different parts. And I thought for this first opportunity to talk to you, let's talk a little bit about the title of the book, what the struggle was like in communist Cuba, and how you got here. And as we go through our subsequent interviews, we'll get to the real warning signs that Americans need to be aware of. But you're a Jersey guy, and you're a proud American. How did it all start? Tell me about the boy who said no.
Well, let's, let's begin how the book got about to begin with. First of all, I must say that I had a great childhood in Cuba. I was born in a very, very not sophisticated town in Havana. My father, my mother, and four or five of my siblings living with us, and we had a very happy growing up in Cuba. We lived through the whole thing, through our religious matters, through our Santa Claus coming every year, no problem whatsoever. 1959 came, and something changed in Cuba. Was a revolution happening with Fidel Castro coming down from the hill fighting, of course, the dictatorship of Fulgencio Batista. It was a dictatorship, and I'm not gonna say it wasn't, it was. However, the way the communists, the way the Castro regime guided their thought to Cubans was a change of government. Cuba had many changes of government. So the Cuban people got fooled by a new change, a new president, period. Not realizing that the thought behind the whole revolution of Castro was another revolution, was to become.
Frank, let me ask you, let's talk about that. So in 1958, how old were you?
1959, actually, when he took over, I was 12 years old.
So in, I want to go back to 1958, though. So you were 11 years old before this happened. Right. You've lived 10, 11 years now. You've had at least six Christmases that you remember. Santa Claus comes to the house in 1958. Things are great. There's a Christmas tree. There's celebration. There's family. There's food. 1 year later, what was Christmas 1959 like?
1959, Bill, is like nothing happened. We went through 1959, not a problem. Cuba didn't change at the time. 1960, things started turning around. Cuba had relationship now and conversation with Russia. Having the very, very, a lot of difficulties actually with the United States. President Kennedy didn't like the situation in Cuba. And as you know, the Bay of Pigs came in, and that changed the Cuba Revolution forever. Because in April 17, 1961, he declared Cuba a socialist state. So it was part of Cuba, Russia, China, and the Soviet Union, period. The United States was out of there, and we had a blockade right after the Bay of Pigs.
And so what was that like to live through that? What was the first thing that changed? So on April 16th, you were not declared a socialist state. And then on April 17th, you were. So did you go through up to the Bay of Pigs where okay, we have a new government, but it doesn't really affect us. We still have our jobs. There's still food on the table. I can get to a doctor. Was that first year and a half of Castro kind of the status quo? Not much different?
Well, to me, it wasn't any different. Remember, I'm 13 years old. I had no clue what a political party was, what socialism was. He declared Cuba socialist. What is that supposed to mean? I have no idea. I didn't know what the Soviet Union is or was or what they do. So I'm sure there were many Cubans that knew what socialism was. But the majority of people in Cuba, we didn't know what it was. However, that year, 1961, Castro decided to do something that changed the world. He wanted to change how the world perceived Castro. He decided then to teach, to read and write everybody in Cuba. He wanted to be the leader of that. And that's where I became part of the situation. That's when everything changed for me and my life. Up to that point, and this is important, this is very much part of the book, I was very, very into with my grandfather. My grandfather was a person who was a mentor to me. I was always go fishing with him. He got, by the way, three or four sons, older, my uncles, but they weren't fishermen. I was the one. So I was back and forth with him. My grandfather, what he did for a living, he owns apartment buildings and he owned houses, and that was his living. 1961, I was sent to the mountains in Cuba to teach others how to read and write. I was just finished my sixth grade. How can I possibly teach anybody how to read?
How were you, Frank, how were you sent to the mountains? Did the Red Guard came in? I mean, how did this work? The military showed up, or did they send your mom and dad a letter saying, hey, great news, Frank won the lottery. He gets to go to the mountains and teach us how to read and write. How did this happen?
Actually, they do it very smooth. Just the same way they're doing it here today. Very smooth. They went to the classroom where we graduated in sixth grade, and they promised a life. Have you ever been in this part of Cuba? Have you ever seen the mountain? Have you ever seen the hill? Have you ever seen it? Would you be willing to help others? Every kid say yes. Well, me and my cousins and my, you know, a whole bunch of, yeah, we'll go, man. My mother didn't know. My father didn't know. That was too late. I already say yes. So me and my cousins and all that.
Who told your parents? Did you tell them or did the school
tell them? They came to my house. They knock on the door and say, your son is going to Oriente. Now, mine, I don't know where Oriente is. I had no idea that Cuba had mountains. None of that. But Bill, I was sent to those mountains for 9 months.
Wow.
Without any communication with my parents, not even a letter, because there's no way to go up there. I was brought up to that place in a cargo train, where they put the cows and everything all the way to Oriente. It took more than 7 days to get up there. And then we started a walk all the way to the mountains up there. I didn't even know where I was. I remember I was taken to a house. Nice people. I was taken to that house, and this army guy took me there and told the people, this is Frank, and he's going to stay with you to teach you how to read and write. And they looked at me. They looked at the guy like, what the hell? I didn't ask for this. And I didn't want to be there. They didn't want me there. So it was a really awkward situation for the first month and a half that I was with people. Now, they are descendants from Jamaica. They have lived their life in there. They have a different religions that I have. I'm Catholic. It was so awkward because nobody was talking to me. Nobody would allow me to, you know, show him how to read or write or do things. And I cried like a little baby. I cried and cried and I cried. But you know what, Bill? I said, I am not going to die in this mountain. Not me. And I remember one day, when they get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, they all do, even the kids, because they had no school or no anything. When they got up, I got up.
What were they, farmers?
Yes, they went to do the build, you know, grow the beans and sugar canes. And when they went that morning, I was outside waiting for them. And I went with them. And I started working and working and working. And before you know, they learned how to respect me and how to see me as part of them. And sure enough, I started teaching them how to write their name, how to do this, how to do that. And we create a great relationship. I thought that I was never going home. This is 9 months. I couldn't even see my cousins that were 2 mountains away. We didn't know. And we created a tremendous relationship.
Frank, go back a moment. When the soldiers came to your home and said, your son has volunteered to go to the mountains, he's going to teach people to become literate. This is the goal of our government, to make everyone read and write. Obviously, so they could teach them all the propaganda that they wanted. You control the education. You control the future. What did your mom and dad say? Was there a, were they, must not have thought it was as bad as it could have been, right? I mean, imagine they didn't, you know, they didn't fight and nobody, your mom didn't tackle the soldier. They're like, what? What did you volunteer for? I can imagine your father was really mad at you.
That is a great point, because up to that point, my mother is not aware, just like me, of what's really going on. My father knew. My father knew that this is something different. And my mother, of course, she went off on this guy. What are you talking about? Where are you taking my son? They didn't know. Well, we don't know where he's going. What do you mean you don't know? Who's going to be taking care of my son? We don't know. When is he coming back? We don't know. How is he going to eat? Who's going to feed? I don't know.
And wow.
He went off on these people. And my father is trying to hold it back. Hey, stop. Hey, woo, come here. Let's talk.
Because he is knew. That because he understood that things had changed and the military was in charge?
He knew that the military was in charge. I'm sure that the looks that he was getting from that lieutenant, he knew that if you don't shut your wife off, we're going to do something about it. Yeah. So he finally said, no, let my son go. He'll survive. He's a little boy, my mother keeps saying. Wow. He's never been away from the house, away from Havana, away from the people he knows. How are he going to? He'll survive, my father said. And there it was. I was on that mountain for
now. Wow.
And Bill, when I, one day, the same soldiers, the same few of them came to the house, knocked on the door, and said, Frank, you're coming home now. You're going to your house. 9 months later.
Wow.
Jack, I didn't know if, are you serious? I mean, should I go or should I stay here?
Was it hard to leave? I mean, you had built a relationship with this family.
They were all hugs and cries and could you come back, please? And you know, it was really hard. It was really, we really create that relationship. And it was so rough for me. When I came back from that mountain, I was a different person. I was not a 13-year-old boy anymore. I was a man, completely. I picked coffee, I dried the coffee, I sold the coffee in the cities, I did the sugar cane, I do the beans, I did everything that the farmers in the mountains do. Remember, there's no equipment there. This is all by hand.
Wow.
I did all that. So six months into the mountain thing, I even had my own mule. You know, I was a big guy now. I had a mule. I had a machete, my hat. I was part of that.
So did the soldiers let you take any of that? I bet you didn't get on the train with a machete.
No, I didn't take anything. They took everything back. You're going home. What do you mean? Now. Let's go.
Wow.
That's the way it was.
Just in the middle of the day. That's it. You're done.
Middle of the day. You're coming home. And so, the train took back another 5 or 6, 7 days to get back to Havana. And Bill, when I went to my house, my whole neighborhood, my whole town, everything had changed. Everybody was quiet. Nobody would talk to you. My grandfather's property, all of them, had been confiscated by the government. All of them. The only property he owns is the one that he lives in. All the 6, 7, 8, 10 units in that building, 6, 7, 8, 10 units in that building belong to the tenants that live in the building. They're no longer
gave them. They gave the renter the property. Here's yours.
They gave it to the tenants. They're there. They pay rent to you for many years. You're abusing them, not yours. And the other thing that happening immediately that there were lines of people trying to get food. You cannot go to any store you wanted to go, like we used to do all the time. You have a number and a name and where you live. This number allow you to purchase your groceries weekly or monthly or bi-weekly in this particular store, store number 14. You cannot go to the store down, two stores down. That's your place. If the foods are there, you get it. If they're not, tough.
Did you still have cash money or was it an allocation? You get a certain amount per person.
No. In my case?
Yeah.
No, in my case, they gave me like $5 for all the month that I was there. Every month, so $45, $50, let's say. And I took that money. I gave it to my father when I came home. I had no use for it. I was a little guy. But nevertheless, my father continued working. So the money he had was enough to buy food for the house and all that. But that was a change for me. Number one change, my grandfather lost all his property. Number two, the food, the way you buy the food, the lines of people, the people protesting and arguing. The revolution start losing faith in the people and the thought that everybody want to overthrow Castro's regime. They immediately start doubting of people. They start blaming people. If you don't agree with what they say, you're an enemy. And if you're an enemy, you must be destroyed. Just like happening here today, all right? So that's the way it was. They created what is called a committee of the revolution. Bill, a committee of the revolution means that every single block in my town, in Havana, I don't know if that happened in Oriente or those, but in Havana, every single block, there was a house or somebody who lived in that block that was responsible for everybody in the block. Meaning that if Bill lives in this block and you want to go to Woodbury, but you live here in Mantua, you have to ask permission to that guy and he'll give you a little passport, just like the one you need now to get in an airplane that you were vaccinated, one of those. It's a permit.
So, and how did that person get picked? Was it someone who was a soldier? Was it someone who that Castro identified? Or did they take people from the revolution and say, you're now going to live on this block and you're the guy in charge? Or was it the neighbor down the street? You're like, I knew this guy. Now all of a sudden he's in charge.
Neither one of those. The guy they picked was the lousy neighbor that never cleaned the house and never cut the grass, that never painted the house. And they're always fighting with everybody in the neighborhood. That everybody for years hated his guts. That was in charge of the place.
Wow.
Now, you want to go someplace, you have a problem. He may say, no, you know what? I don't think so. You're done.
That's it.
And what
gave him the enforcement? Were there soldiers there, or he could just pick up the phone and or talk to a guard and that would be it? You'd be in trouble. You'd be in jail.
Absolutely. He's in charge of that block. But in the region, there was a committee that controlled the region. And there are, you know, socialist party members and this party members. Those people could actually take. Remember, they eliminated all the judges. There was no Congress. There was no Senate. There was no right for you to argue with anybody. If you have a problem with this guy, you will go to the central committee in the region and they will judge you there and find you guilty or they're not.
And Frank, what happened to all those politicians? I mean, it's a good history lesson for people that there was an effective government for a time. There was dealings with American businesses, with phone companies, casinos. I mean, there was a lot of wealth pouring into Havana during the early 1950s.
Bill, They run. They have money. They were corrupt, just like unfortunately. I'm so sad to say, we have many politicians in here that are making a lot of money. They can care less about what happened in New York City or anybody else.
They don't care.
Just making money. It's their position. Well, in Cuba, it was exactly the same. Cuba was the last country in America that should have been socialist because we had everything that the United States had at the time that came. New cars, new this. When you had it here in America, we had it in Cuba too. It's the same. The dollar was as strong as the peso in Cuba. There was no need for Cuba to be socialist, but the corruption allowed these people to do what they're supposed to do. They divide the country. They say things that we're not supposed to do. They kill the Supreme Court of Cuba completely. They destroy our constitution. They did everything that they're supposed to do to dismantle the government the way it was. All our heroes, the people that fought for Cuba, all the statues of our heroes were knocked down and destroyed. All of a sudden, we had new heroes. So here I am. I'm coming from that mountain. I'm finding all this out. I was not in my house, not even a week after I came down. In 1962, I was sent to a special school for 2 years. You know, sixth grade, seventh, eighth, and ninth grade. I never finished the ninth grade there, but they sent me I was there for 2 years.
And what was the school? Who sent you? The same group, same military?
Right. Middle school. It was good. They took this town in the coast of Havana, the Tarara, very rich town. They took all the houses from the rich people, and they make houses for people like me to go and study in that place. So that this
What did you study, Frank?
No, I studied. I have math and history. Their history, of course, not mine. Math and history and all that. But the brainwash that they were doing to all the boys and girls in there, and I mean thousands of us in different parts of Havana that I know of, thousands of us, the brainwash was intensive, was there. And I knew, Bill, because of my grandfather. My grandfather used to read to me everything, read about Cuban history, geography, international history, the leaders of this country. I know a lot for my age because of my grandfather. I knew that these socialists were lying to me. And I say no.
I love it. Now, let me just two questions, and then we'll have to break, and then we'll what we're going to do is reconvene next week, and we'll record our second episode, because I want to take it from ninth grade to your decision to get out. But I want to understand, you're in class. You're in what was a mansion of someone who had earned it under the capitalist system, all gone. For all we know, that owner is dead or in prison or who knows.
You're right.
You're with a bunch of other people your age, 13, 14, 15-year-old kids. Did most of the kids know what you knew, or were most of them brainwashed and were you alone?
They did not know what I knew. Remember, those kids are coming from all over Cuba. We didn't know each other. They didn't know how we live in Havana. They come from these different sites. They were very poor people up there. They're here with us. Many of them were very sophisticated. Man, they didn't care what you teach them. You give them food, you give them clothes, you give them school, and you promise them they're going to be an engineer or the future doctors in Cuba. But that was great. It just was something wrong. Something was, and I couldn't go to my house. They allowed me 12 hours every month to go to my house.
Wow.
12 hours. And remember, I don't live right next to my house. I got to take a bus and get there, come back. And I have to be on time back. So it was a nightmare, complete. And I remember.
How were those interactions with your mom and dad and your brothers and sisters?
When I came home, my mother was really upset. What are they doing to you? What are they doing? My father, my grandfather, and everybody listening to what I had to say. And about this these people in Lenin in Russia and Marx in Russia and the doctrine, the socialist doctrine, and how we're going to transform the world and the international community and things that you never heard in your life. And my grandfather said, watch out. They're coming after you. They're going to transform you into a socialist or member of the Communist Party. And once you sign up for the Communist Party, you cannot get out of it. And I never forget that, Bill. Never. And that was the first time that I say, this is not for me. And I am 16 years old. And I already said, this is not for me. Think about that.
So next time we're going to talk, Frank, about that decision that you said no and right. And that journey as it started after all of this brainwashing, all of this separation, isolation, fear-mongering. I mean, it really is amazing the parallels that we can see through history. When you think about Cuba, Russia, Germany in the 1930s, I mean, there are so many similarities where all of a sudden people wake up and say, wait a minute. How did that happen? The most important thing you said a lot of incredibly important things, and I'm looking forward to the next few conversations about this. But one takeaway that I hope our audience really understands is, even though the revolution happened overnight in a few days, the transformation took a little bit of time. It was a year and a half. It didn't really turn around, but once it flipped, it happened fast.
Well, you're absolutely right. And that's why I'm terrified of what see happening in our country. You're right. It didn't take 1 month. It took 2 years because they had to dismantle the Supreme Court. They had to dismantle the army, per se. They had to dismantle the Congress, the Senate, and everything you knew in the local level.
You wonder, Frank, how the history would be different if during that transition in 1960, when the revolution happened, but they weren't taking the kids away yet because they were still trying, even the communists were trying to figure it out. How do we do this? If there had been a revolution at that point to fight them, and that's part of the message here. It's during the time where it's not so bad is when you need to act and fight back. You don't wait until it's too late. That's a big lesson.
Listen, if you allow them to grab a hold of what they're trying to do,
Frank, the book is called The Boy Who Said No. It is the Frank Mederos story. It can be purchased on Amazon. Is that correct?
You can purchase on Amazon. You could go to any bookstore. You can order from there.
I will put a link. And then when we come back for our next episode, let's start when Frank is 16 years old and your grandfather gives you that warning that once you become a communist, you can never get out. It's like the mafia. They pull you in. Yeah, it's it. The life. That's your rest of your life. Frank, it's been a real pleasure and an honor to talk to you, and I'm looking forward to our next conversation. Thank you for joining me.
The honor is mine, and I'm looking forward to talk again. Yes.
Thank you, Frank.